to thank the movement of Bravo and the network for the study of the history of the monastic economy, for the invitation to make this talk at the beginning of our workshop tomorrow. Many esteemed colleagues and good friends are participating in the network and the workshop, and my talk today is very much based on their efforts to investigate how monastic economy matter in different historical cases and periods. I will just make a general interview. Sasha, I have 12 pages, so, but it's about your work as well, so be patient. From medieval to modern times, monastic institutions, especially in the Orthodox Christian world, have an impressive historical continuity. Some of the monasteries on Mount Athos, for example, have a continuous presence for over a millennium now. How can we explain this continuity? Is it only because of the religiousness, undoubtedly, of both the monks and the faithful across ages? In my talk, I will argue that this continuity has to be also explained on the basis of continued, albeit different in character, in different historical circumstances, relations of the monastic institutions with economic activity and political protection. I will focus especially on monastic landholding across the ages as the basis of their economic stability in both medieval and modern times, even today. Secondly, I will focus on political protection in favor of the monasteries in various states and societies, even Islamic ones, a case in point being the Orthodox monasteries under Ottoman rule. My specific field as a historian is Ottoman history. Last but not least, I will make an effort to include into the analysis and discussion the role of the monastic networks, religious, economic, and political at the same time. Methodologically, after separating as good modern historians the patterns of monastic activities in their cultural, economic, and political aspects, I will argue that we have to keep in mind that from the perspective of the medieval and modern monks, all these aspects were combined together and practiced as a whole. This unity of behavior might have also contributed and contribute even today in our post-industrial age to the survival, stability, and even success of the monastic institutions. After all, in the midst of economic crisis, the world is always in search for stable institutions. Already in the rich landscape of late ancient ascetic monasticism, centrally organized monasteries, like those of Pachomius in Upper Egypt, were present and functioning as economic entities. In Asia Minor, Basil of Caesarea established the first urban monastery after returning from his studies in Athens in 351. A bit later, in the turn from the 4th to the 5th century, the writings of Nilus of Ancyra advise that the proper economic basis of an urban monastery should be either the wealth of the founder or the patronage of affluent benefactors. Patronage of rich officials and families, including emperors in some cases to monasteries, became a pattern in the imperial capital of Constantinople, the center of ecclesiastical and political power in the Byzantine world. In the 6th century, the founding of monasteries, such as St. Patrick and Mar Saba by Justinian, and Syrian monasteries by Theodora, contributed to the wealth of the monasteries. Having personally visited St. Saba, Mar Saba, 2 weeks before, in the desert east of Bethlehem, I can assure you of the continuity of the wealth of the monastery, even in between the Israelis and the Palestinians and their conflict. The key of its survival is landholding, of course. According to the Oxford Handbook of Byzantine Studies, the profuse, I quote, rhetoric of monastic texts, the predominant literature of the Byzantine world, continually stresses monasticism role apart, its eremitical withdrawal from the affairs of society. This should not blind the reader to the fundamentally important political and social functions monasticism played out within the Byzantine experience, not least after the 10th century, when monasteries often became significant landowners. As far as the Byzantine economy is concerned, Angeliki Lairou and Cecil Morisson have argued that, I quote, collectively, it was the monasteries that were the largest landlord during the last centuries of Byzantium. The monastery of Lavra, the richest monastery of Mount Athos, is a good example. In 1321, the monastery possessed 185,000 modi, that is around 18,500 hectares of land in the districts of Thessaloniki and Strymon and the island of Limnos. Its annual fiscal revenues, consisting of the dues of the parity, the dependent peasants, and various tax exemptions, amounted to 4,000 gold coins. Its economic revenues would be in the order of magnitude of more or less 5,000 gold coins, $750,000 in today's prices. That is not huge, but again, not bad. I wish I had this kind of money. According to the same experts in Byzantine economy and the study of the domain of Lavra by Nicholas Voronos, landlords showed a marked tendency not only to enlarge, but also to rationalize their holdings. We know this especially of large ecclesiastical landlords, for whom the accumulation of property through donations by the state or the individuals, large and small, and through purchase, or the gifts of people who entered the monastery, was easier. They sought to buy or acquire through donations lands that were contiguous to their existing holdings. The economic benefits are obvious, since transportation costs between various parts of the domain are minimized and the cost of management are reduced. A prime example of such rationalization of property ownership is again the monastery of Great Lavra, whose arable lands and vineyards increased considerably between 1300 and 1321, and which sought to acquire continuous parcels of land. According to Kostis Virglis, who has studied the properties of the big Byzantine monasteries, the lion's share of the annual surpluses of those monasteries was directed systematically towards the acquisition of land properties. This is exactly the conclusion from the study of the monastic archives under the Ottomans as well. Thanks to the donations and the purchase of land, the monasteries increased the volume of their land properties, unifying better manageable land estates, commercializing a part of their agricultural surpluses, and last but not least, making their institutions more powerful. However, the emphasis of the monastic economic strategy on land acquisition might have also negative effects on their productivity. Investing into land acquisition could have been directed instead to land improvement works. Moreover, the expansion of the monastic lands occurred at the expense of other landowners and the peasants themselves. However, the monasteries seemed that they were ready to ignore these negative effects in order to acquire more lands. Why? Suspense. I would argue that because the stress of their economic strategy was on control and continuity of their land properties. The properties of secular landowners changed hands on a regular basis due to inheritances or after confiscations by the state. The monasteries, on the other hand, were able to overcome inheritance rules and confiscations with new acquisitions, even under the Ottomans, as was made evident during the confiscation crisis under Selim II. Having secured their position in the economy, the monasteries should have achieved better productivity in comparison with the lay landowners. This was made especially evident during the last century of Byzantium, when, during the decades between the Serbian and the Ottoman conquest of Mount Athos, 1345 to 1387, at the time when the Orthodox Christian aristocrats in the Balkans were losing their properties, the Athonite monks managed to preserve their properties and even expand them. Even after the Byzantine confiscation of 1371 and the Ottoman expansion at the expense of many of their properties afterwards, the Athonite monks survived quite well. During an age of insecurity, the Athonite monasteries, thanks to their relative economic status, continued to exploit at a certain degree their estates, building fortifications and moving peasants from one estate to the other. A safe and holy mountain, as Elizabeth Zachariado has successfully described it. In this respect, the monasteries became factors of economic stability and continuity, laying the foundations for the renaissance of the monastic economies during the second half of the 15th century and afterwards. In modern capitalist and post-capitalist economy, survival in the economic game is still the key factor of profit, I would argue. Productivity and innovation are much praised, but they are good for nothing if you do not survive in the game. In order to survive, you have to stay in the game. The monasteries, at least some monasteries, stayed in the game during the age of insecurity and profited from that. Is it possible to say that the monks have developed a modern economic strategy of survival? In my opinion as a historian, absolutely not. But we will have to take into account that in contrast with the lay landowners, the monasteries were institutions managing a symbolic capital, emphasizing continuity over immediate profit. Thus, investing on continuity might have been an economic strategy that was, in retrospect, more successful. We have also to take into account the fact that the big monasteries were collective enterprises of many monks, including also, during the age of insecurity, the Balkan aristocrats who had found refuge for themselves and their properties in the monasteries, employing a variety of economic initiatives. At the time when individuals and households, aristocratic or not, were struggling for survival, big monasteries were by default anonymous, or rather eponymous, companies with multiple shareholders who were able to launch different initiatives and acting under a very, very good brand name, religion. Mount Athos Co. Unlimited. According to the Byzantine chronicler Pachymeres, on the 15th of January 1303, the emperor Andronicus II sent an order to all the monasteries of Constantinople to pray all night in order to prevent a great evil of unknown origin that was about to occur. According to the former patriarch Athanasius, who had foresaw the divine wrath. This episode illustrates the mentality of the emperors and the Byzantine Christian society, that the monks were in position to protect the society and the state. Their prayers were thought to contribute also in the victory in war. For the monks themselves, this mentality was the key for achieving political protection. Even under the Ottoman Sultans, the monks were eager to project this mentality to the Muslim Sultans. According to a supposedly imperial autograph, Hafi Sharif, of Sultan Selim I, a document forged by the monks of the monastery, the Athonite monastery of Xylopotamo, in the first half of the 18th century, the Sultan gratefully attributed his victory over his enemies and the conquest of Egypt in 1516 and 17 to the intervention of the 40 saints, Kirk as Islam, described in the document as angel-like, handsome, young men, armed to the teeth. All Padishah, reads the document, God Almighty sent us as a favor to the realm of the family of Osman. By God's decree, we gave you strength to rout your enemies. Therefore, it is now appropriate for your imperial majesty and greatness to do us the following favor in return for the kindness we did to you. If some monks come tomorrow and ask your all-embracing grace for an imperial permit to repair the home where our relics repose, if you wish our friendship to endure, you must grant the aforementioned monks your permit to restore our ruined home, after you have offered them the endowments which are appropriate to a generous and munificent sultan. We are the 40 saints, supporters of the padishahs of the family of Osman. In the past, we eased the passage of 40 unarmed Ottomans from Anatolia to Romania, who then seized the Akbash fortress just by throwing stones at it. In the present, we supported you in your great wars, we defeated your enemies, and this is how we offered you the realm of Egypt. Well, in reality, the Ottoman Sultans were not so much as the monks would like, eager to protect the Orthodox Christian and the monasteries in particular. Especially after the consolidation of the Ottoman Empire, during the reign of Suleiman the Magnificent, the son of Selim I, the Grand Mufti of Constantinople, Ebu Sul Efendi, in the context of the Islamization of the Ottoman law and in the conjecture of acute need for ready cash at the outset of Selim II's reign, created a legal excuse for the confiscation of all ecclesiastical and monastic property throughout the Ottoman Empire. As stated in a contemporary short chronicle, in that year, that is 1566, Selim became Sultan and destroyed and plundered the monasteries and took their livelihood. Alas, his rage and inhumanity. According to a letter of 20 March 1569 from Bishop Evgenius of the monastery of St. Catherine, Mount Sinai, to the Habsburg Emperor Maximilian II, I quote, all the sources of revenue of all the churches and monasteries in the entire empire, wherever they may be located, be sold. The monks of St. Catherine were compelled to mortgage their assets at great cost in order to limit the purchase price of 5,000 gold coins. The threat was very, very serious for the survival of the Orthodox Church and monasticism under Islamic rule. In contemporary England, the dissolution of the monasteries by Henry VIII, in order, like the Ottomans, to fund his military campaigns, was one of the most revolutionary events in English history. It is very interesting to know that in the case of the Ottoman Empire, the Ottoman dissolution of the monasteries was finally avoided, at least in the cases of many big monasteries, like those of St. Catherine and Mount Athos. The Ottoman confiscation crisis has been studied by Alexander Fotich and John Alexander. Like in the case of St. Catherine, the Athonite monks repurchased their properties at great debt and accepted the fiscal encumbrances on them. Afterwards, however, they made an undisguised threat to the Ottoman state in fiscal social terms, in the terms it best understood. I quote from the document I think Sasha has published. However, if an imperial confirmation rescript is not graciously issued in accordance with the old decision, then we, the monks, will have to return the aforementioned properties, we will have to remit the gold coins that we garnered by selling and borrowing, and each one of us will disperse into the world. The monasteries will thus be deserted, and it is certain that the lump sum haraj that we gave each year will be lost. So this is the fiscal, the social fiscal threat. In the end, a delicate compromise was achieved in order to allow the continuation of the status quo ante in a newly regularized form of what had been actually enjoyed and reaffirmed. Thus, as the monastic communities at great sacrifice in 1568 eventually redeemed most, if not all, of their properties, they also gained a reaffirmation of their status under the new law. By the way, just a few days ago, the Greek Supreme Court of Appeals rejected an appeal by the monastery of St. Anastasia in Chalkidiki, a dependency of the Patriarchate of Constantinople, for an exemption from the tax on property of the properties of the monasteries that are not being used for philanthropic purposes. Maybe the modern monks should read the terms of the compromise of their ancestors with the Ottoman Empire in order to get better results from the state. It has been argued that the violent dissolution of the monasteries in England made capitalism and brittle capitalism possible. By handing over expropriated land to barons in exchange for their political support, Henry Tudor destroyed the network of translocal monastic orders, which had helped create and uphold the complex space of intermediary associations that mediated between individuals and the state, including peasant communities and guilds in the cities. So, should we argue that the compromise between the Orthodox monasteries and the Ottoman Sultan after the confiscation crisis prevented or retarded, in retrospect, the advent of capitalism in the East? At the same time, the Ottomans had to wait until the 19th century before trying to control the Islamic pious foundations, the Awqaf, the other big landowner in the Islamic East, during the period of state centralization, which is known as the period of Ottoman reforms, Tanzimat. In England, centralization of power and wealth started already from the 16th century, when, during the enclosure movement, land ceased to be commonly owned and became privatized. This was the crucial process of primitive accumulation that created the surplus wealth that was used for finance and speculation abroad. The perennial sanctity of life and land was subordinated to the secular sacrality of the national state and the transnational mind. Thus, capitalism was born. By contrast, elsewhere in Christian Europe, the papacy and the monasteries provided a counterweight to secular national monarchs and their vassals. The same can be argued for the Muslim and Christian institutions in the Ottoman Empire. I am using this very bold historical comparison in order to illustrate the importance of political protection for the survival and continuity of the monastic institutions. Even if we do not agree that the dissolution of the monasteries made capitalism possible, it is true that the monasteries in England did not survive the hit by the state. In the Ottoman Empire, thanks to the compromise of 1568-69, they survived, at least some of them, and many of these institutions survive until today. Now, my last effort in this talk will be to discuss the monastic networks. From late antiquity onwards, monasteries functioned as intermediary associations that mediated between individuals and the state, including peasant communities and guilds. Peter Brown, in his seminal paper concerning the role and function of the holy man in antiquity, has shown exactly this intermediary role of the monks as a key for their success in late antiquity. Moreover, monks and monasteries were also participating in the medieval moral economy of the crowd, to cite E.P. Thompson. They were present to help their neighbors in case of need, when the state was not. During the Ottoman centuries, Ottoman and Greek monastic archives are full of documents showing social protest against monasteries, mainly through trespassing into monastic land and pastures, their metocha, the dependencies. On the other hand, however, we can argue that the very existence of these monastic lands functioned actually as a reserve for the peasant communities in case of need. Monastic lands were not enclosed. At the same time, were free for trespassing in case of need. At the same time, monasteries functioned also as pre-modern banks, places for secure deposit of cash and precious objects behind their high walls, and also lending cash money with interest to individuals and communities. Not very high interest. Like the Islamic vaqfs as well. I saw that Lydia Kotovani will talk about the banking activities of the monasteries in our world. Moreover, the monasteries with their symbolic capital in Pierre Bourdieu's terms were generally very careful in the management of this capital vis-à-vis their flow, that is, the peasant communities and the guilds of the cities. In many cases, as I have already mentioned, there were tensions. In other cases, however, relations between monks and laymen were very symbiotic, as Sofia Laiu has emphasized. In cases of epidemics, for example, laymen asked for divine help through the monks, asking from the monasteries to send them holy relics. In some studied cases, whole villages promised annual deliveries of wheat to monasteries in exchange of regular visits of their holy relics in their villages. In other cases, the monks took the initiative themselves to make a tour of the holy relics in order to collect money for their monasteries in different parts of the Ottoman Empire and even outside of the Ottoman borders, in the Western Europe or in Russia, the so-called Zitie in Greek. The monks made their travels with reference letters from the abbot of their monastery, the local bishop, the patriarch, and the sultan himself. In the case of the Athonite monastery of Xeropotam, mentioned already before, the scholar monk Kesarios Trapontes traveled between 1757 and 1765 through the Danubian principalities, Constantinople and the Aegean, carrying a big piece of the Holy Cross, as well as copies of a series of forged documents. Chrysopolis of the Byzantine Emperors, Theodosius II, Romanos Lecapinos and Andronicus II Palaiologos, including the Hadi Sharif of the Sultan Selim I I quoted before. His aim was to collect funds for building a new Catholic hall, a new church for the monastery, the one that exists today, based on a design by a renowned Greek architect of the Sultan in Constantinople, very a la mode for the 18th century. This is how Caesarios described his tomb in verse, and this is my humble effort to translate them freely, very freely in English. The humble Caesarios took onto his shoulder the Holy Cross, and the man Anthimos followed the cross. All the Xyropotamo fathers prayed loud, and the 40 saints helped out. The Holy Cross was full of energy, and all embracing God showed us mercy. Think how much support, how many people helped without pity for making this church so pretty. Moldavia gave with all her soul. Valachia donated as a wall. Constantinople helped all the way along, and the island of Chios assisted for so long. The island of Samos paid its share, and the island of Psara offered there. The island of Skopelos and Negroponte as well helped all the way and kneeled before the cross all day. The towns of Ceres and Salonika, Smyrna and Mytilene, and other places. What do you think? They didn't pay. This is a poetic description of a trans-territorial network of places, people, communities, all around the Ottoman Empire, mobilized from the Xyropotamo monks in order to support their effort to build a new church in their monastery. These kind of networks created ties among the Christian Orthodox of the Ottoman world and beyond, and strengthened the idea of a Christian Orthodox commonwealth, sharing cultural beliefs, social standing, and economic funds. In the Age of Enlightenment, however, these monastic networks became the target of sharp criticism on behalf of the rising secular Balkan Greek bourgeoisie. For the anonymous author of a pamphlet promoting a radical Greek constitution, Ellenική Νομαρχία, the monks were simply thieves. I quote, "The majority of these bone sellers originate from the Mount of Athos, which they call a holy mountain, and where their monasteries are located. These monasteries have palaces and houses in every town. They call them Metochia, and the traveling monks stay there. It is in these places where they count the stolen money from the floor, in order to keep half of them for their personal gain and to send the other half to their monasteries. Demolish all the monasteries. Κατεδάφισον όλα τα μοναστήρια." That was the preach of the age of the radical Greek Enlightenment, bearing resemblance to the preaching of the Reformation, but 2 centuries ago. In the context of the Reformation and counter-Reformation in Christian Europe, a historical process which has been described as the age of confessionalization replaced the ideal of the ascetic man of the Orthodoxies with that of the soldier of Christ, Christianus Miles. The soldier of Christ was not living outside the society, nor acting as arbitrator, but was fighting inside the society. The Protestant preachers and the Catholic orders became the soldiers of Christian virtue and replaced the monks as mediators, holy men in the search of the holy by the society. In this way, and especially after the French Revolution, which has targeted the institution of the church as a whole, the Western European states proceeded in the confiscation of the monastic lands. In 1782, Joseph II in Austria established a church fund, funded from the confiscation of the monastic lands. In 1834, Belgium and Portugal confiscated their monastic properties, no longer considered inalienable. Spain followed in 1836. The Greek state, established after the Greek Revolution, under Bavarian administration, also started the process of confiscations in 1833. However, this was a process which was never completed systematically. From the 600 monasteries in the new Greek territory after the revolution, only 151 remained. However, most of them, the most important ones. It is interesting to note that in the Greek case, the peasants were eager to support the monasteries and the monks, which they saw as socially helpful in the context of their moral economy against the state. Research has shown that in the Greek state, the monks and the monasteries were careful not to raise conflicts with the local populations. They also offered land, food, war, protection, as well as the opportunity of social mobility in a violent world, where the states and the local prelates were ready to take all from them. Between 1917 and 1927, the monastic properties in Greece became the target of another series of reforms. In 1928, however, the monasteries of Mount Athos and their dependencies passed from the Ottoman Empire to the Greek state, with a special status outside of the jurisdiction of the Orthodox Church of Greece. When Greece entered the European Union, this special status was reaffirmed. In our days, Mount Athos is, for instance, excluded from the value added tax area, but it is a part of the Schengen area. However, again, a declaration attached to Greece's accession treaty to the Schengen Agreement stated that Mount Athos's special status should be taken into account. In 2003, a resolution of the European Parliament requested of the lifting of the ban to women visitors for violating the universally recognized principle of gender equality. However, this is not likely to become true. At the same time, restoration and conservation works in the Athonite monasteries are co-funded by the European Union. Mount Athos is also in the list of UNESCO's World Heritage Sites since 1988. Finally, the Athonite monasteries are in our days at the center of Orthodox monasticism in Greece and beyond. In our post-industrial world, some of these monasteries, like Vatopedi Monastery, control important assets in the form of real estate. In 2008, the monastery of Vatopedi was implicated in an alleged real estate scandal. The monastery was being accused of trading low-value land for high-value state property in a deal with the government. The cost to the state was believed to have been at least 100 million euros. After the story became public, the government cancelled the land deals and two ministers resigned under huge pressure from the media and public. However, the abbot Ephraim and the monk Arsenios of Vatopedi were relieved from the accusation from the Supreme Court of Greece in 2012. The monastery of Vatopedi, very interesting monastery, has also initiated semi-independent international politics, hosting twice President Vladimir Putin of the Russian Federation. Yes. Well, he will not go again after what happened to Ukraine. So they turn to the United States now. Another interesting story, last story, I promise. In In 2005, the monastery of Katopeli hosted a Sunday Mass to celebrate the restoration of its 16th century vestry. Funded by whom?
Charles.
You will not find it.
Charles.
Yeah?
Charles. No, England.
The Catalan administration. With 200,000 euros. The ceremony was held exactly 700 years after Catalan mercenaries, hired by the Byzantine Empire to fight against the Ottomans, failed out with the ruling Palaiologos dynasty and swept through Greece and Mount Athos in 1305. According to Father Arsenios of Atopedi, the idea to fund a restoration at the monastery originated from a Catalan musician, Joseph Terror, who visited Mount Athos some years before and was informed of the Catalan raids by a monk. The conversation was somehow intense, and Terror was quite impressed with the story, according to the newspaper. Quoting Arsenios, he subsequently told his poet friend Carlos Duarte, then General Secretary of the Catalan administration, who decided to restore a building in Matopeli as a way of an apology, with 200,000 euros. The Matopeli monks opted to restore the monastery vestry, which houses religious ceremony items, icons, documents, and gifts from the Byzantine Empire. According to the media, the Sunday Mass was attended by a Greek minister, the Catalonia Regional Interior Minister, and a representative of the Spanish Embassy in Athens. That was before what happened in Catalonia. I believe that this story is a good illustration of how the Athenian monasteries can play an interesting role in the global economy and politics in our days, including Greek, Bulgarian, Serbian, and Russian monasteries as well. The monasteries of Mount Athos are at the same time mnemonic intrusions of the Byzantine and Ottoman past, and also heritage sites in the post-industrial world. After all, as I have argued at the beginning of my talk, and I hope that we will discuss today during our workshop, in the midst of economic crisis, the world is always in search for stable institutions. In that sense, monastic economy somehow still matters. Thank you for your patience.